good. Thank you for the invitation. And obviously, I would rather be in France, in close to Paris, for this occasion. But yeah, let's keep fingers crossed that next year will be under better signs. So today I want to present some joint work with Gleb Koshoboy on maximal green sequences. So first I want to talk a little bit about cluster algebras, since I don't want to assume that everyone is familiar with them, and then introduce maximal green sequences, and then give some combinatorial constructions for certain maximal green sequences on certain cluster algebras. And so let's see. First, we start out with a quiver Q, finite quiver, and we don't allow loops or two cycles. So here we have such an example. I mean, we can see there can be cycles, but just two cycles are forbidden, and one cycles. And due to this setup, there is associated a cluster algebra due to the work of Fomin and Silvinsky. And we denote this cluster algebra by AQ. Okay, so this cluster algebra lives inside the function field generated by the initial cluster variables, and these are just some indeterminants in associated to the vertices. So in this quiver up there, we have four vertices, and to each vertex, I associate a variable. And in the field of rational functions of these four variables, there will be our cluster algebra living. And to obtain it, we start out with the polynomial rings of these four variables. And then there is an inductive procedure, which takes as an input this quiver and our initial set of cluster variables, and produces a new set of cluster variables and a new quiver. And this procedure goes on and on. And well, whatever we obtain after doing this infinitely many times, possibly, is our cluster algebra. And this procedure is called mutation at the vertices of Q. So for each vertex, we can do a mutation and obtain a new set of cluster variables, which we have to add to our algebra. So essentially, the datum is we have a quiver Q and our set of initial cluster variables. And we do mutation at the vertex K to obtain a new set, a new quiver, and a new set of variables. And we have to do this infinitely many times to obtain our cluster algebra. So how does this look in more detail? This procedure of obtaining obtaining the new datum consists of four steps. So one is we take our cluster variables and we change them, but in fact we only change the one where we mutate. So if you mutate at vertex k, we change the cluster variable ak, and it's going to be replaced by 1 over ak times the sum over two terms. And one term is the cluster variables attached to the incoming errors, and the other the product, and the other summand is the product over the cluster variables of the outgoing errors. So this is what we do to the variables, and then we have to do also something to the quiver to keep track of things. And first we need to add transits through the vertex k, then we reverse all errors at k, and finally we remove the two cycles if any of them occurred. So let's see how this looks in our example. So our quiver, we had x4, x3, x2, x1. So we replace x3 by x3 prime, which is x1, which is the incoming error, plus the product of the two outgoing. This is x2 times x4 divided by x3. And then we have to change the quiver. So there are transits from x1 over x3 to x2 and to x4. So I get two transits from x1 to x2 and from x1 to x4. Then I have to remove to reverse the errors at k.
Sorry, your variables for A now is X's, yeah. So it's.
Oh yeah, that's probably because I drew them by hand. Yeah, yeah, and, that's correct.
And you know there are A and X cluster varieties, so it's really central.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a little. It's kind of unfortunate. So yeah, this should all be A's. Yeah, as pointed out, there is a dual procedure on the X side of this. But this looks a little bit different. I mean, the quiver stuff is the same, but on the variables, there's the dual thing happening. All right, thank you. Okay, so this is this mutation. Let's do another example to see what kind of stuff we get from this. So the easiest, I guess, non-trivial example is the A2 quiver. And we have two variables, X and Y. So we can mutate at both of our vertices. Let's first start our algebra. It comes with X and Y already. Then we mutate the first vertex. The error, there is no transits, of course. We can just turn around the error. There will not be two cycles. So we see the error will always flip. I forgot to say, if you do this process twice at the same vertex, then you go back. So you won't get anything new. So in this example, we have two vertices, so we can only mutate 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. We cannot do 1, 1. I mean, then we go back and don't get something new. So and if we compute, then the x variable goes to 1 plus y over x, and then we mutate at 2. So, and we obtain this term down here. And well, it's the rational function of 1 plus x plus y divided by xy. And we go on mutating at 1. Then our first variable changes again. And we obtain 1 plus x divided by y. Before we had 1 plus y divided by x. We mutate at 2. And well, we see that the second variable becomes x again, which is already a little suspicious. But then we go on and mutate at 1. And we see the first variable becomes y. So in conclusion, we are done because we already have symmetric expressions up here. So this will be our cluster algebra in this situation. Usually, though, this procedure will not stop. So it will be infinite. In fact, due to Fomenzi-Levinsky, there's a theorem that there are only finitely many cluster variables if and only if the cluster algebra comes from a Duncan quiver of type ADE. So most of the time, it will not stop. There is, however, a second notion of finiteness due to Keller and also appearing in the work of Gajotto, Moore, and Neitzke, implicitly called maximal Green sequences. And this is a more broad notion of finiteness. And this is what I want to discuss today. So for this, we start with a quiver Q and associate to the quiver Q a framed and a Q co-framed quiver. So what is this? Well, let's just do it on an example. So if we take A3 quiver, we obtain the framed quiver by adding copies for each vertex. And then errors from the corresponding vertex downstairs to the new copy. And the co-framed is dual. I mean, the dual construction. So let's say if this is V1, V2, V3, we call the downstairs vertices V1 bar, V2 bar, V3 bar. All right. And they are a little bit special. So they are frozen, which means we are not allowed to mutate them. All right. They are basically there to record some stuff for us. So this is the framed and co-framed quiver. We just add vertices and errors downstairs or upstairs. Now we call in a vertex of our quiver green if there is no incoming error from a frozen vertex. Yeah, I mean, this is not, I mean, not just for the framed and co-framed quiver, but if I have any setup where I have a set of frozen vertices and a set of not frozen vertices, I can make this definition and say a vertex is green if all errors which connect this vertex to frozen vertices are outgoing. And the same I can define red is if there are only incoming vertices from frozen. So let's nevertheless look at the example we had of the framed quiver. And here we see, of course, each vertex has exactly one error to a frozen, the downstairs error, and it's always outgoing. So all three vertices, so all vertices are green. So basically framing is like making everything, like defining everything to be green, like as an initial setup. But now we can also mutate this quiver, not at the frozen, but at the mutable vertices. For example, at the vertex V1. And what will happen? Well, we'll get a transit here from V2 to V1 bar. And the error from V1 to V1 bar will turn around. So that will make V1 red. And well, the other two vertices will stay green, but we see that the situation is a little bit more complicated than in framed or co-framed. So yeah. However, the definition still makes sense. And in fact, there is a theorem due to Dirksen, Weimann, and Silevinsky, which says that if we start with a framed quiver, so not just any ice quiver, but with a framed quiver, and mutate it by a sequence S. So S is just a finite sequence of mutation steps, so finite sequence of vertices. Then after doing this, every vertex will have precisely one of the two colors, red or green. Yeah. So like in this example, we have red, green, green, but this is completely general that they are partitioned always. All right. So this is the setup. And now, Keller defined the following. So we look at, again, at a sequence of mutation steps or a sequence of vertices of our quiver. And this sequence we call green if all of the vertices are green. Yeah, I mean, of course, not in the initial quiver, but when they are due to be mutated. So basically, we only mutate at green vertices. Yeah? So after I mutate the first I minus one, I want to, again, mutate at a green one. And this is also the term of reddening, which is like making red. So this means that after I finished with the sequence, everything is red. And then there is maximal green, which means it's green and reddening. So so I cannot extend it the green anymore because everything is red already. Okay. So let's make an example. Let's look at A2 again. So we get our framing. We have two green vertices. And let's mutate at the second vertex first. The error here will turn around. And we see there's no transit. So just the error from the second to the frozen second will turn around and will turn this error red. And now we can mutate to the first one. And similarly, just the first error will turn around. And we already have a maximal green sequence consisting of two mutation steps here. So that's nice. We could, however, also have started with the first vertex and mutate this one. And in this situation, we get the transit. So here's a little bit more complicated, the ice quiver we obtain. And we see what happens when we mutate the second quiver now, the second vertex now. We have a transit here from the first to the second to the first frozen. And this will give us a vertex from the first to the first frozen, but this will create a two cycle, which we have to cancel. So so we will obtain this quiver here. And we see we mutated the second vertex, which becomes red, but here the first vertex became green again. So it's not always just that this one vertex flips. And then we mutate the first again, and now we have a red sequence, a reddening sequence or a maximal green sequence, which was three lengths three here. All right. And something we see here is that these two quivers are isomorphic as ice quivers. Well, okay, I mean, they're not that big, so it might be a coincidence, but this is a general theorem due to Preussler, Dupont, and Perrotin, which says whenever I have a maximal green sequence S, then there exists a unique isomorphism between, well, I mean, the reddening I created and the initial quiver when I co-frame it. So that's nice. What does it give us, these green sequences? So they have nice consequences. So if a quiver Q has a maximal green sequence, then under some my technical assumption, the Fogonchorov conjecture holds for the cluster algebra AQ, which says that there is a nice canonical basis parameterized by the mirror dual cluster, tropical points of the mirror dual cluster algebra. And this is due to cross-hacking Kehl and Concevich. So this is very nice. There are other consequences. So the refined Donaldson-Thomason invariants due to Concevich-Seubelmann, they can be computed as a product over certain quantum dialogues where the factors are indexed by the mutation steps in the maximal Green sequence. So this is due to Keller and also pops up in work of Gaiotto, Moore, and Neitzke. So in particular, also we obtain quantum dialogue algorithm identities from this. So for example, if we look at the A2 quiver, we obtain the identity EX, EY is EY, E, Q to the minus one half, XY, EX, where E is this quantum D-logarithm. So, and of course, for other quivers, kind of complicated identities arise this way.
You should add the X and Y Q commute, yeah.
Come again?
You should add that X and Y Q commuting variables, not commute, yeah. X
yeah.
And Y, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that's all. Think it's one need not necessarily maximal green sequence, just reddening sequence. So
yeah. That's true. Yeah. Do you know if there's like any theoretical advantage only inherited by maximal green sequences, or is besides that they are easier to find somehow?
No. No, I prefer reddening sequences.
Yeah, normally, yeah, but okay, but also to construct them or for theoretical purposes?
I don't know. Yeah,
exactly. So usually the properties are inherited by reddening sequences and not maximal green sequences, as far as I understand. But the maximal green sequences, they're somehow in some situations more canonical, so which makes them easier to find. Maybe. Okay. So similar, one can formulate this that for physicists that the BPS spectra can be computed with these maximal Green sequences. And I guess that's the point of view of Gajotto, Moore, Knightske. So cluster algebras where the quiver possesses maximal Green sequences have very nice properties, which we want to have. So the question is which quivers possess maximal Green sequences. And I mean, like some examples I want to list is an acyclic quiver has a maximal Green sequence. There are a lot of examples in physics. So for example, Gajotto, Moore, Knightske, Alim, Cicciotti, Cordova, Espa, Bodi, Rastogi, Waffa, Al-Lamara, Melal, Zaidi, and other works where maximal Green sequences are implicitly at least constructed. There is also work of Maguet where he constructs maximal Green sequences for the double Bruhat-Teil associated to SL for E for the identity and the longest word. So, and this has a cluster structure due to Bernstein, Fomin, Silivinsky and cluster three. So one question is, what about other types here than type A? And what about other double Bruhat cells? What's the picture here? So, and one way to do this is to look at this triangle product QR of two quivers. Oops, Q and R. I kind of like to call them A and D for acyclic and Duncan, but it's also confusing A and D. So let's call them Q and R. This is defined by Keller, this triangle product. And basically you take the product of the quivers and you triangulate it in the sense that you like everything which comes not triangulated due to the product is gonna be triangulated. So let's do an example. D5, triangle product A4. So first we take the product of the two quivers. And now we have to triangulate it in the sense that when I go blue and red, then there is a diagonal always. Like if the quiver before the red quiver is not triangulated, then I don't change that. Okay, so this is the box product, triangle product. And one question which arises is if we can combine maximal Green sequences for the individual quiver to obtain a maximal Green sequence for this product. And The answer here is yes, if S is a source sequence and T is the sink sequence. Yeah? So they are maximal Green sequences by assumption. S is a maximal Green sequence of our first quiver and T a maximal Green sequence of our second quiver. And if you furthermore assume that S is a source sequence, so it only like the points where we mutate are always sources at the point when we mutate them, and T is a sink sequence, then we can combine them to obtain a maximal Green sequence for this triangle product QR. So this I want to demonstrate on an example. So there's this nice applet written by Bernhard Keller, where you can work with mutations and quivers of cluster algebras. So once we open the page, it already starts out with this quiver. And what can we do? We can add some nodes, we can add arrows, And then if we click on a vertex here, then the mutation has been performed. And also we can freeze nodes. And this way we can control for green and reddening sequences and these things. So let's see here in our example. We have here the A4 quiver, and we want here a sync sequence. So let's see. Maybe you should check for green. So we can also do an add framing, which adds like the framing all at once. So we don't have to do this individually. All right. And we can also hide them. So now here we want a sync sequence. Let's see if that works. All right, sync, 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 sync. So that's okay. And here we want a source sequence, but that always works for acyclic. Good. So now how to combine them for the product, for the triangle product? Well, we start with the sync sequence here and do one whole round of the source sequence here. And then we move on. And you see what happened downstairs now happens upstairs in the product. So this is all very well behaved in this situation. So we stay always within this realm of, there probably is, sometimes it gets some numbers, it confuses them. Let me see, I somewhere prepared this. So I guess this example is D4 times D4, which is a little bit harder to see. And let me see if we can do it here. So I already implemented it, and now I just forward and work through the sequences. So this was one time the sync sequence in the base, and now we do it again. Second time, and we start again with our sync at 7. All right, not done yet. Okay, so here we have this reddening property. So we found a maximal green sequence here. And so this works in general if you have this sync sequence downstairs, sync maximal green sequence, and source maximal green sequence on this side. Okay, good. So let me go back to the slides. All right. So now where we have established this, the question is how to find these source and sync maximal green sequences, or when do we have them? And well, one thing is the source maximal green sequence is equivalent to the quiver being acyclic. And about the sync maximal green sequence, well, we know that if the quiver is Duncan of type ADE, then there exists such a sync maximal green sequence due to result of Pristler, Dupont, Perrotin. And we conjecture that this is equivalent. I don't know if someone in the audience has an opinion about this. Okay. So so this would mean that this construction works for products of acyclic quivers with triangle products of acyclic quiver with Duncan quivers. So what's the upshot for our initial question? Well, for these cluster structures introduced by Bernstein, Forman, and Silevinsky on the double Bruhat cells, we can actually obtain the quivers as full subquivers of box products of where Q is a Duncan of the same type as G, and R is just an A to the N. So this means that for these cluster algebras, we obtain maximal Green sequence with this construction. We furthermore obtain optimization sequences for the frozen vertices of these double Bruhat cells. And so this is basically the same technique. Thus we can, the work of cross-hacking Kehl and Koncevich produces actually the desired basis here. Okay. So let me show this optimization sequence property. So here we have D4 times A4. And well, we freeze the ends of the Duncan diagram. Yeah, so this, that's why they are blue, they're frozen. And this is because, this comes naturally from the cluster structure of these double Bruhat cells. So it's something one has to deal with. And optimization sequences mean, like, for example, the vertex 10 here has an ingoing error from 11 and an outgoing to 2. And optimized is if there's only ingoing error. So, so it's like, yeah, I mean, it's like similar to this screen, but it's for the frozen vertices. So the colors here we can ignore. This is just because because of these frozen, so but they don't have meaning for us now. So what we do here is if we have and the situation that the outgoing error is on the level, we can just mutate on the level line and one can show that this is an optimization sequence. So for example, if I look here at the 16, I can mutate 15 and 14. And then I have only an ingoing error and this is optimized. So this works fine. But if I want to optimize the left-hand side, the same principle wouldn't work. So what we do here is we apply similar techniques as for the Green sequences, but for maximal red sequences for this quiver and for the mutual subquiver here. So I start here with the sink and mutate here, and this looks a little bit messy on the right, but that's fine because we did that already with the right. I mean, we already found optimization sequences, so we basically can cut them off and forget them. I mean, we don't need them anymore, as long as the left-hand side stays nice. And this is just because it was not a sink in the full quiver. The mess on the right. All right. So now if you forget the right-hand side, we see that this, the rest of the quiver is isomorphic to what we had before. So we know we're already done when we now go level lines. So here, then I have only ingoing errors. So we get these optimization sequences. So in some sense, it's a little bit of a similar game, these optimization sequences and maximal Green sequences. But in optimization sequence, we don't start with the framing, like there are several errors. This somehow is related to, this is like the non-commutativity of matrix multiplication in a sense. Okay. So this is this. And last thing I have to I want to say is so the sync source type of maximal Green sequences, they can be defined more generally. So this was not just for triangle products. So for example, I mean, there are several versions to formulate this, but if you take gamma as an acyclic graph and R just for simplicity is now AN, then we can do the following. How much time do I have?
Yeah, I think 15 minutes.
15?
Yeah.
No. I think it's a mistake.
Well, I won't need 15 anyway, so. So this is a very simple acyclic graph. And as a base, we take AN here. And now we just write some copies of these, some parts of this AN quiver here. And we draw inclined arrows, which just alternate between the level lines here, but not in the product way. They can skip something. And be a little bit more irregular. And here we can also produce a sync source maximal Green sequence because the graph is acyclic. So essentially we need that the projection onto the graph is acyclic in each step if we define it the right way. But if the graph already is acyclic, then this will always be an acyclic quiver. That's one thing we can do. Another generalization is we can also allow, for example, multiple inclined lines here, but they have to be compatible. So they have to induce the same orientations on this graph gamma in this projection way I hinted at. So so just two examples. So if you want a sequence for the circle, we can write it as like this, where we have here A whatever, and here just the one point. And this is our inclined thing, and this produces us here a maximal Green sequence. Or we can have multiple inclined arrows. So there are five arrows here, five here, five here. So let me get the pointer. Five here, five here, five here. Then there are three, then there are two. And here there's one and one. So they're a little bit messy. But for example, we write them as there's a blue one, then there is a double red one, which stops here, and so on. And to this blue, red, and yellow, we associate now the sequences which they produce. Like zero stands for the bottom line and one for the top line. And if I look at the blue one, it produces 0, 1. While the yellow one produces 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0. And well, the green line and the red line as indicated here. And if you write them underneath, we see that they agree in the initial pieces. Like in general, if you have more level lines, they have to be shuffled in accordingly. But since they agree here, this works and we obtain a maximal Green sequence here. And it's given by 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0. This means we first go level line 0 all the way. Then we go 1, then we go again 1, then we go 0, then we go 0, then we go 1, then we go 0. So let me also display this. Yeah, this is the quiver we just looked at. And I first go in the bottom line. Then I had a one, so I go in the top line. Then I have again a one, I go in the top line. Zero in the bottom line, zero. One, zero, and the last was three. Yeah, so I mean, the way they are constructed is that the bottom quiver never gets disturbed by the top quiver and the other way around, right? I mean, if you have this property, then you can always combine the sequences for the sequence of the bigger quiver. And it will also be compatible with the how it moves the framing, because the level lines don't interact in this way. Okay, so I have one more sequence. So thank you for the attention.
Thank you, Volker. Do you have any question for Volker?
Yeah. I have just very small questions. This triangle product which you defined, yeah? It's for quivers, and quivers are, in fact, we understand it's a quiver's potentials and generic potential, yeah? Is it some notion of product for quivers with non-generic potential?
Well, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. I didn't think about this because in our applications, right, we take like acyclic and Duncan to obtain something for these double Brouwer cells, and there we don't arise at this problem, right?
You don't have potential from the very beginning.
The potential comes up in the triangle, but not in the factors.
Yeah, I see. Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know what to do what happens with the potential. I mean, probably Bernard Keller knows, but.
Yeah, and also, by the way, if you get this product for acyclic quivers, which you get triangles, so you get some generic potential, but can you exhibit kind of explicit example of this generic potential, because it's kind of a bit elusive object. You should remove infinitely many hyper surfaces in some parameter space.
What do you mean by we get the generic potential?
You see that if you have a quiver in general, then you consider all possible cyclic words, which could be starting from cubic words and so on, and make all possible linear, infinite linear combination, get infinite dimensional general vector space. And then in this vector space, infinite dimensional vector space, you get countably many algebraic hypersurfaces when you get troubles after some finitely many mutations. But in the complement, will be like very irrational. And for this tensor product, you get you get infinitely many cyclic words. So exhibit just one concrete generic potentials. It's not obvious problem in sense, yeah.
You say it's not obvious how to write down a generic potential.
Yes. Because when you make choices, you can make wrong choices.
I always assumed it's... for this kind of quivers like triangle products, it's not a problem, but I don't know.
For example, here it's a naive story. You get all small triangles, yet just all small triangles is weight one, and that's it. Yeah, but maybe it's the right choice. Yeah, but I don't know.
Yeah, but maybe also for the more general situation, it could be a question. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Another question.
Maxim, so this theorem, so if we have quiver which possesses proximal green sequence, then the Jacobian algebra is finitely dimensional.
Yes. In this case, maybe for this maximal green sequence, you get kind of unique.
Yeah, so maybe from this we can extract some canonical potential.
Yeah, in fact, I'm not sure. You see that for any quiver, you get certain field of maybe of transitive degree, which could be finite, infinite, this number of parameters of all potentials, modular gauge transformation. So you get this huge field of unknown transitive degree, and. There is this class P of quivers when you get generically only like field will be rational numbers. But yeah. For such things, I don't know. Yeah. And in principle, when you make this merging, this reading sequence, you get automorphism of this huge field. So you don't have really canonical potential.
But what's your point of view? Is it like that the point is to get to have a nice potential and just to work with it, or is it the interesting thing also to study how the potential?
No. The right question is maybe you consider this field of rational functions and coefficients of this potentials, just rational functions and infinitely many variables, and consider invariants under gauge transformation for this completed path algebra, get certain huge field, which is preserved under mutations. And then if you make this maximal sequence, you get automorphism of this field, kind of like birational automorphism of some variety, maybe infinite dimensional. And the canonical potential will be fixed point of this birational automorphism, whatever it means. Yeah.
Yeah, but then does the canonical potential, does it have meaning, or is it just what to work with?
I don't know. No, you see that for surfaces, for example, consider this apartheid graph on surfaces, there is a kind of canonical Calabi-Yau three category. So there is a canonical gauge equivalence loss of potentials, which is preserved under mutations.
Can you provide us with reference? Or maybe just we can communicate.
I don't know. Yeah, but this is perspective from Foucault categories for some non-compact Calabi-Yau three folds gives you a kind of implicit definition of what is the potential. I don't. Uh-huh. I'm not sure that it was really calculated.
Okay. So then we ask you privately.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So generic potential is somehow still more interesting to consider than exceptional cases. Is it in a way your message?
It's not clear. Yeah, even for surfaces, what is the dimension of space of potentials? The transcendence degree is not clear. Yeah, when you get this black and white.
So, but what could be an interpretation to a study like potentials which are not generic?
No, you see, these mutations make sense for this Calabi-Yau collection of spherical objects in Calabi-Yau three categories. Just the trouble that you not always you can do mutations. Yeah, sometimes you should stop. Yeah, it belongs to a different perspective. This Calabi-Yau three Calabi-Yau categories. Yeah.
But how we can use this existence of Riedemann called maximal green sequence to construct the potential?
It's kind of different story. Yeah.
So it's not just will give us some equation like for this dilogarithm identities.
No.
Okay, so then we will.
No, strictly speaking, these potentials modify dialogarithm identities, because when you have potential, then you consider this sheaf of vanishing cycles and trace of Frobenius and things like this. You get identities for something, and only for generic potential you are sure that you do with dialogarithms, otherwise you do with something else, but still you get some identities. Mm-hmm. But they kind of will be different identities. We have kind of special potential, not generic one.
Yeah. Do you have some examples?
Not really, but but for example, I remember we're gonna have three vertices and this three arrows going from first to two to three, or maybe two goes from first to two, two to three, and three to one. The something which is under mutation goes to itself, yeah. Mm-hmm. There is hidden, I think, elliptic curve, and it depends on the elliptic curve. If it's this complex multiplication, one can, using this Matievic invariance, can produce something slightly different, yeah. Yeah, there was some little ambiguity.
So where's the elliptic curve hidden?
Just a second, elliptic curve. maybe I'm wrong. But those choose some one parameter here. And in this case, when you consider DT invariance, it's determined up to some series in some center in this Poisson algebra. And it was I think it was elliptic curve and consider space of representational query get as a parameter spaces will be some elliptic curves, motifs of elliptic curves appearing in the middle.
Parametrizing what I mean? What,
a representation, of, yeah, because even consider vanishing cycles and fix, consider model space of object in three Calabi categories, then it's some dimension vectors you get non-trivial varieties which are critical points of potentials, and that will be, and the cohomology will become, is if I'm not mistaken, cohomology of some elliptic curves depending on how exactly you choose the potential for this quiver.
Mm.
Yeah, so it, yeah, so it gets some non-rational varieties at the end of the day as a modular space of representations.
So definitely, we have to ask you more parameters.
Okay, yeah, maybe as a time, yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you, Rance, for the nice talk.